Our special guest this week, one of the greatest captains in Maple Leafs history, Hall of Famer Darryl Sittler, and the Restaurant and Bar Support Fund, Joe Tilley Sports, coming up! All right, welcome to the program. It's a great program for you today, folks. I know you're going to like this one. Our special guest today spent 16 seasons playing in the NHL, 1,096 games, 484 goals, 637 assists. Former captain of the Maple Leafs, a member of the Canada Cup gold medal winning team in 1976. He set an NHL record with 10 points in one game. He set an NHL record with 5 goals in a playoff game. He is in Hockey Hall of Fame. You can see his name on Canada's Walk of Fame. He is involved in numerous charities. Ladies and gentlemen, the pride of St. Jacobs, Ontario, Darryl Sittler. Darryl, welcome to the program, buddy.
Thanks, Joe. Good to be here. How's everybody? Good?
Yeah, we're good, man. We're doing okay. We're riding the storm, as they say, and do what we can and getting through this, right? One day at a time.
For right? Sure.
So, you know, I had a chance to read your book recently, just finished it probably a week ago. Captain, My Life and Career, written along with Mike Leonetti. A great book. Loved it. Learned a lot about you, Darryl. It was a terrific book, and you had some great stories in there. One of the things that really stuck out for me in reading this book is, you know, I saw time and time again how hard you worked to get to where you were. And I'm thinking, well, maybe, growing up in St. Jacobs with 7 siblings, maybe it was just hard work just to get your share at the dinner table. Tell me, what was it like growing up in the family in St. Jacobs?
Well, St. Jacobs was a small town. My dad was a crane operator, so he was basically working from paycheck to paycheck to take care of us all. And we learned at young ages, if we wanted something, we had to go out and earn it and work for it. Home Hardware was one little hardware store then, and my granddad worked there, and we didn't have a rink, so Mennonite community, so we played a lot of games on the outdoor rinks, and we had to go to Elmira, which is about 4 miles away, to start playing minor hockey. But I was fortunate as a kid, if you were good enough, you could play up a level, you know, so I was playing peewee and bantam at the same time, bantam and midget. But I also I left home when I was drafted by the London Knights at age 16. So you grow up pretty quickly when you leave home. And I was fortunate it was only 60 miles from where my mom and dad and my brothers and sisters lived. So they would get down and watch me play. But I always believed, and still today, if you want something, you got to go out and earn it. And I was fortunate at a young age to realize that you have to do the little things day in and day out to get better. You can't just show up and expect to play on the power play or make the team. It's all those things you do behind the scenes and conscientiously work on the things you don't do well. Whether you're a hockey player or a business person or a teacher, whatever you are, it's those little things you have to analyze yourself and say, hey, how can I improve? And then do them, take the time to do them. So I was fortunate to fulfill my dream. I was fortunate to be drafted by the Leafs. Close to home, St. Jacobs. My granddad, my dad's dad, he had 12 children, so big family. So lots of family members around to watch and follow and support me throughout my career. So I'm a pretty fortunate guy that way, for sure.
Yeah, my mom and dad both came from large families. I think there's 12 in my mom's family, 11 in my dad's. You also mentioned your Uncle Tom in the book. He was a great influence on your life. Tell us a little bit about that and that influence and how that affected you.
Well, sometimes, life-changing things happen to you unexpectedly. And my Uncle Tom was my dad's youngest brother. So he was only a few years older than me. And he loved sports, and he would take me everywhere. And he was like a big brother to me. And I've always remembered him. And he was killed in a car accident, a single car accident. And it really hit home for me to lose one of my best friends, my uncle, like my big brother, at such a young age. But what I did, rather than take that as a negative, I used Tom, his influence in my life, to inspire me. So if I was running or training and wanted to give up, I said, no, you got to do this one more for Tom, one more for Tom. And it's always been that way. And And to me, I'm sure other people have had that in their lives where there's influences, and if you keep your heart and your mind open to them, they'll be there, and you can use them in a positive way. So Tom's been that way and still is today, and that's why I wrote a page about him in my book.
Right, his spirit lives on and through you, and I think that has a lot to do with that work ethic as well. And when you made it to the London Knights, London Nationals, I guess the first year there, you were there, and it took two years there, and you were named the captain of the team. So you've been showing these leadership skills all the way along, and the fact that you worked that hard, I think obviously people saw that in you, and you were a good inspiration for the rest of the players on the team.
Well, it's funny. When I was drafted by the London Knights, I was the third pick overall, and Turk Broda was the coach at the time. And my dad loved Turk Broda. He followed the Leafs, and Turk was a star goalie then. But Turk came to my little hometown to meet my parents, and we took him out for pigtails and sauerkraut. That was kind of a German dish back then. But I always remember Turk Broda, when he left, he pointed, he always talked with his one finger, and he said to my mom and dad, "I'm going to make a hockey player out of your son," you know. But I had a lot of respect for him. He only lasted the 1 year as a coach there, but certainly he taught me a lot. I was fortunate to be in a good organization in London, and I got a chance to play. Sometimes in junior hockey, the players that left before you, like Gary Unger and Walt McKechnie, had turned pro, so as a 16, 17-year-old coming into London, I got a chance to play lots, and I was fortunate to do that. And then Jim Gregory and the Leafs drafted me in 70. And I always remember that things changed a lot since then. The draft was on a Saturday. I remember it was in June, and I had to earn extra money. I was building swimming pools, working for a pool company, and we were in an old steak truck with gravel and wheelbarrows on the back, and the radio was cracking up, and it was right around noon on this Saturday afternoon, and it comes on Daryl Sittler was drafted by the Maple Leafs today. So that's how I found out. And then, I don't know, a week or two later, I got a call from the organization. But certainly things have changed a lot since then, for sure. But honored to be a Leaf. And I was so glad that I was drafted by them.
Right. Drafted eighth overall. And tell us about getting the number 27 and what that was like and what that meant to you. It was kind of like, wasn't really your idea. It just sort of happened, right?
Well, yeah, a lot of people ask that question. They think that when you're drafted, you have a choice and ask for a number. I was number nine in with the Knights, and back then, number nine, Gordie Howe, and a number of other players had nine, so it was a big number. So when I went to Leaf training camp, Jim Gregory, again, the general manager, took me down to the Leaf dressing room, opened the door, and he walked me over, and he pointed. He said, "Daryl, you'll be sitting over there," and I noticed a 27 jersey, which right away it it struck me, because I knew Frank Mihalovic was a key part of that organization at 27. It wasn't a popular number with other teams back then, but for the Leafs, Frank made it popular. So I felt it was an honor for the Leafs to actually give me that number as a first-round pick. So I was humbled by it and knew that, hey, I had great expectations to live up to. And, you know, now I look at it back now, they've honored both Frank and I, retired the number in the Scotiabank Arena, and we both have our statues on Legends Row. So after I had retired, a few guys had worn 27 before, because we actually didn't retire the numbers. They just honored you with the number. So the 100th anniversary, when Brendan Shanahan came in, the Leafs made a policy and tradition that any Leaf number that is hung up in the banners, it's retired and no other player will wear it. So it created some controversy at times when players would wear those numbers of other players. So now we don't have to worry about that. Mm-hmm. It's great that I'm up there with Frank Mihalovic.
You know, in your book, you talk about, you know, the humble beginnings with the Maple Leafs when you were in your rookie season. I think you guys had a training camp in New Brunswick, and you mentioned that a couple of kids were standing outside asking for autographs, and somebody got your autograph. And what happened after that? I like this story.
Yeah, that was pretty good. Yeah, that was actually my very first game. So, you know, you're nervous, you're excited. We're going down to, we flew in the afternoon of the game to Moncton, and these kids had played hooky from school. So they're all excited to get an autograph, meet a player for the first time. So we grab our bags and walking out to the bus, and I'm watching these kids. They're getting Dave Keon's autograph and Norm Allman, Paul Henderson. They were the stars. And finally, two little kids came up to myself and another rookie, Bob Liddington, and they had this kind of scrunched up piece of paper and said, "Sir, can we have your autograph?" So I signed it, Liddington signed it, and we handed it back to the little kid. And we're getting on the bus, and I'm looking at him, and he's trying to read the names. He says, "Oh, just a couple nobodies." He actually ripped it up and threw it down on the ground. So humble beginnings. But I said, "I bet you a little bugger wish you had it today." I'm sure. There you go.
Yeah. When you were going into the Hall of Fame, I think you know that little autograph that he had might have come in handy. So you did have some ups and downs in the rookie season. You had the broken wrist that set you back a little bit. And how much did that set you back? How did that affect you, your career?
Well, first of all, when I played junior hockey for all 3 years, I was a centerman. And when I was in Leaf training camp, we were strong at center. So they had Dave Keon, Nora Malman, Jimmy Harrison, and I think Mike Walton might have even been out there at the time. But so they moved me to left wing. So there was a big adjustment for me playing left wing. And then there's my first goal. I didn't score.
Yes, we're looking at it, yes.
November 28th, I guess it was. But if you notice, I went into the net there to grab the puck. The goalie was Smokey McLeod, and that was his first game in the National Hockey League, and the first goal that he let in. So I grabbed the puck instead of giving it to him, but still have it today. Probably hold it up. But when I broke my wrist, that was in January. I got hit at center ice. Joe Marat, big strong defenseman, creamed me, and it shattered in about 15 pieces. And I remember going to the hospital and the doctor telling me, and then I had to wear, I was out 3 months, and I had to wear a brace on it with a hinge on here and a leather strap so that if I got hit again, it would prevent it from breaking again. So it took me a long time. It took me almost 2 years to be able to shoot the puck with the same velocity as it did before. So it set me back. So my first year, I think I scored 10 goals, my second 15. And then what happened my third year, the World Hockey came along, and Normie Allman and a few of the guys left. And it gave me a chance to play. I was 2 years older, but to play center. And then I led the team in scoring my third year. And then things kind of took off from there.
Right. And then, Dave Keon left the team. And Ron Ellis he seemed like the next guy in line. But Ron Ellis did something unusual. Knowing Ronnie the way he is, it doesn't surprise me. But he made a suggestion to Jim Gregory that you should be the captain of the team. And what was that like to be named captain of the Leafs and to have that honor and to have Ronnie as his endorsement?
Well, I didn't know that was happening behind the scenes. I know when Dave left that they were going to name a new captain. And to be quite honest with you, I thought it was Ron Ellis because he was such a statesman. He was there when they won the cup. He's a classy guy, as you know, and he's a leader. But when Jim Gregory had mentioned to him, he just said, "I think Daryl should be the captain." And that was really kind and an honor of him. But I think he probably felt that maybe at the time it was the better thing to do at the time for the team or whatever. But certainly I remember the day I was named captain. I always thought back to what the history and the tradition of the Leafs mean to the hockey world, but to fans and to everybody else, and to respect it. And it's important to do good leadership things on the ice as it is off the ice, you know. And so I got involved in that. But I also remember making a point. I was disappointed on Harold Ballard on how he treated Dave Keon. Dave Keon had won the Stanley Cup, Conn Smythe Trophy, had been a captain for a number of years. And he was just kind of thrown and discarded like that was all meaningless. So I stood up at the press conference and said, "Hey, listen, I don't agree with what he did with Dave Keon, and who knows, someday that might happen to me, and it's not the right thing to do." So those are things that happened. I've always tried to believe in leading by example, because people do look for you. Sometimes you don't have to say anything. It's just how you present yourself, whether you're on time, your work ethic, all those sorts of things. And I still believe that's as important today, whether you're in hockey or anything you do, that, you are who you are, and people watch and follow that. And to me, that's important to have, to be a strong leader and be an example.
Right. Did you feel pressure wearing that seat? Did it add some pressure to you?
You know, you mentioned earlier about being the captain in London, so I knew a little bit about that, having some pressure and being a captain. But I've always believed that if you have a good relationship with management, which I did and we did, and you have good, strong leadership players around you. So even though it was a captain, you had guys like Ronnie Ellis, Lanny McDonald came into the organization, Tiger, Boria. It makes your job as a captain a lot more easier, I guess, to do, that you have that support, and there's a communication between management and players, and to me that's so important. So I had all those sorts of things, and I just went out and tried to do my job. And you know what happens in Toronto when things are going well, the captain gets a lot of credit for those mm-hmm. things that are going well, and when things aren't going so well, then it can turn on you quite quickly too, and I've experienced both of those. But you got to be true to yourself, good through the good and the bad, and just know that, hey, that's the most important thing, and let that outside stuff don't take it as seriously as some people do. You know?
Right. At the end of the day, when your head hits a pillow, you can live with yourself, right? You're doing the best you can, right? Yeah. So February 7th, 1976 seemed like any other day. You know, we were about to face the Boston Bruins. They were an elite team on their way to a 113-point season. I think the Leafs at that time were one game over 500. Tell us about that day and Dave Reese, who went into the game, by the way. You know, people talk about Dave Reese. His record was 7-4-2. He had a couple of shutouts. His previous game, he beat the Penguins 5-1. That was just a couple of nights before. But Jerry Cheever's just back from the WHA. Gilles Gilbert injured. So Reeser got the call that night. And tell us about what happened on February 7th, 1976.
Well, back in the 70s, when there was an original six team playing on a Saturday night in Maple Leaf Gardens, it was a big game. You could feel it as a player. There was a different vibe to it because it was televised across Canada, and it was original six. People still were close to those the emotion of those rivalries. So I normally do things routinely on the day of the game, and that particular day I went down to practice. And on the way home, I was running late and traffic was bad, and I knew my wife Wendy had been out doing things. So when I got home, I knew I was going to have to make my own pregame meal, which I didn't want to take the time to do. So I stopped in and I ordered takeout from Swiss Chalet and moved down some chicken and some fries and had my nap and went to the rink and scored 10 points. But before that, Harold Ballard, who liked to, you know, create some controversy from time to time, he had mentioned in the newspaper article about if he only could find a centerman to play with Landy McDonald and Errol Thompson, that would help the team. Well, that was a shot for me, but I go out and get 10 points. So I guess I was the centerman that he was hoping for. But that was quite a night. I don't think I realized, well, I didn't realize at the time how long that record might last and how big a game it was. We were playing the next night back to back at home, which was unusual. But Dave Reese, the reason he was in that night is Jerry Cheevers was in the World Hockey, and Cleveland Barons went bankrupt and collapsed. So Cheevers was back in Maple Leaf Gardens, but that was his first practice and first time with the Bruins. And Don Cherry and the coaching staff wanted to save him for his debut to play in front of the Bruin fans back in the Boston Garden the next night. So, and when goalies were having an off night, back then the coaches didn't pull them like they do now. They usually let you in and leave you in and let you kind of work your way through it. But the last goal, as you see here, I was trying to pass the puck out to Errol in the slot, and Brad Park stuck his leg and hit his skate and deflected in between Reese. I just put my hands up and shook my head and couldn't believe it. So a magical
one of those nights.
Yeah. It'll be a tough record to beat for sure.
Well, tough record to beat. So since that time, now the record was 8 heading in before that. Maurice Richard's record was 8. Now 11 players have got to 8 since. Not one of them has reached 9, let alone 10. So it's going to be a real tough record to beat. And I don't think, honestly, I don't think it'll ever be beat. One of our viewers, by the way, Ted Manikis, wants to know when you're going to put out a DVD of the 10-point night. He said he'd pay $40-$50 a copy for it right now.
Yeah, well, you know, I it's a little bit of controversy there. I was given the original tape from CBC for that game, and then I transferred it on to VHS, and for some reason, through the different moves, I can't locate that tape, and I wish I can. I've got all the goals off of it and stuff like that, mm-hmm. but somewhere, somehow, hopefully it'll show up. I was hoping through this COVID thing, there might be a silver lining in it, because I was going through a bunch of my stuff that I hadn't gone through over the years. And when you move around and, you know, put it in a DVD player, like the last I watched it was back in early 2000s, 2001 or something, 2002. So I wish I had it. I feel bad. I know the National Hockey League and fans would love to see it again, but I'm apologizing. If it comes up, I definitely will make a DVD of it to show everybody for sure.
So you had a tendency to have some big, you know, there's Reese right there when you guys were honored a few years later.
That was a cool night. The Leaf organization invited all the players and their spouses back on the 40th anniversary. There's Jim Gregory, Red Kelly was the coach at the time, and Dave Reese came in to hand the puck over to me to drop, and he's a good guy. I mean, he was good all the way through it. After the record was set, we would do the odd interview on an anniversary, and he was a real gentleman and cooperated, and you know, just an all-around good guy, you know. And hey, a lot of those goals were good goals. They were just inside the post. You can't blame him for them all, for sure.
Right. Oh, I know. Yeah, they were all good. Well, you had a tendency to do that, Darrell. You had to have big games. I remember, like in junior, you had a five goal game. You know, of course, this night you had 6 goals, 4 assists. That was phenomenal. Then later that year, in a playoff game, you had another 5 goal game. I believe it was against the Flyers. So that was pretty cool. Yeah. Tell us about that five goal game.
We had to win that game. We were down in the series. Bernie Parent was in that. And again, it was just one of those magical nights where the puck had eyes and it went in. We forced the 7th game back in Philly. Unfortunately, we didn't win it. That was the year that Red Kelly brought the pyramids out. We had the pyramid power underneath our and they were going to energize us, and they did energize us for the one game. But when we took them all to Philly, for some reason, we couldn't win that 7th game with the pyramid. But it was fun doing it. Those days, a lot of the coaches had different personalities and characters. And you as sports writers were kind of the same, you know. And now it's a little bit different, obviously, with social media and things going out there like they do. And spontaneously, you got to kind of watch and be careful and kind of how you do things and what you do. Or back then it was a little bit more lenient, not saying it was right or wrong, but it's just the way it was, you know?
Well, that particular series, I remember, the Flyers were vicious, right? They're the 2-time defending champs, and they were, let's face it, they were bullies. They went after Boria hard. But you guys, you guys had a lot of pushback, I know that you weren't having a particularly good series heading into that 6th game. Bernie Parent had sort of had your number, stymied you a number of times, but then that night you broke out for 5 goals. That was pretty awesome. Yeah.
Well, one thing when you talk about the Flyers and back the 70s, and I know, everything has progress, sports or whatever it is, but the element of fear and courage were a big part of the game back then, and the Flyers used to play. And part of their game plan was intimidation. So when you talk about Borja Salming, such a great player and a key guy, I mean, he was their focal point to target and to try to get him off his game. So what teams would do, they would bring in tough guys to combat that. So you would get into some real battles, and you remember watching them, the Downeybrook balls, and you were man for man on the ice, and you had to be able to kind of stand up for yourself. If you didn't, you'd be in trouble. And the fans got involved, and the players got involved with the fans. And it was crazy times. There was always kind of a game within a game back then. You don't see as much as that now, or nearly as much as you did back then. And I think it was part of the entertainment factor for sure.
How close were you guys to going all the way? I mean, you lost to the Flyers in the game 7. I think you were up 2-1 in that, or sorry, you were down 2-1 in that game. It was a close game heading into the third period. I think they opened it up a little bit, but that was pretty close. How close do you feel that you were to using that pyramid pyramid power versus Kate Smith, right?
Yeah, Kate Smith and God Bless America. That was awesome too. But we had a team with a lot of character. We had some toughness and grit. We had, talented players like Borean, Lanny, Errol Thompson, myself, Palmateer, Net. But the problem that we ran into, the Canadians, Montreal Canadians, were so strong for a period of time there. And they had a little bit more depth than everybody else. But if you talk to players who played against our Leaf teams back in that era, they had a lot of respect for us as a team and the character and the type of games we played. So unfortunately, we didn't win the cup, but we had a team that I think got we got the most out of everybody, and we played to our potential, but it wasn't enough to knock out the Canadians, unfortunately.
And then in the summer of 76, you had a pretty impressive season and didn't go unnoticed. You made the roster of Team Canada for 76 in that Canada Cup. And that was a tremendous series and a lot of fun. And surprisingly, it was you and the Czechs in the final, not the Soviets at that time. Were you surprised by that?
Well, what happened with the 76 Canada Cup, we all remember 72 series and the Soviets. I think what happened, it woke us up here in North America to understand and realize these European players were good players and very skilled. And then guys like Boris Salming and other players started to come into the league. So the 76 Canada Cup was the sixth best nations in the world playing against each other. For guys like myself, we were invited to training camp. And Canada was strong, obviously. You had 35 guys invited. 25 were going to make the team. The other 10 were going home. So for me to make the team and get a chance to play was awesome. The other part of it was communism was a big thing back then. Russia and Czechoslovakia were still communist countries. So nobody, any of us, were expecting the Czechs to be into the finals, but they had this good goalie in Cirilla. He was a colorful type of guy. Very jovial, but very, he was having a great series. So for them to get to the finals and to play us, it was kind of probably a shock to a lot of hockey fans. But for us, we really respected the skill and the talent of the Czechs. And it was a good series. We were fortunate to win it. That Team Canada 76 team, 19 of those players went on to be Hall of Famers. Bobby Orr, that was his last hurrah. And to me, it was one of the greatest teams, if not the greatest team Canada put together. So to score the overtime goal, if you recall, at the end of the game, which was kind of cool, we exchanged jerseys. We were standing at the blue line, and Peter Mihaljevic, there's the goal here. Deked Zarella to the net and put it in the empty net, and the rest is history, so to speak. But very emotional for all of us. Pierre Trudeau was the prime minister at the time. And after the series was over, we were all invited to Ottawa in November, to 24 Sussex Drive, and I always remember that Justin Trudeau and his two brothers were sitting on the steps in their pajamas admiring us as hockey players. So here you look all these years later. I happened to was fortunate to sit beside Margaret Trudeau that evening at the head table, and I was asked to say a few words. I was very nervous, 26 years old, speaking before, I don't know, 1,500 people at the time. But you look back with fond memories and you see how lives have changed over those years, but certainly I appreciated being a part of Team Canada. Back then, even Harold Ballard, as grumpy as he could be, he had the receptionist at Maple Leaf Gardens answer the phone, the home of Darryl Sittler. So who would have ever thought? There you go.
Yeah. I was going to ask you about that too. The night you had the 10 points, it was a couple of days after he said that if you only had a center to play with Lanny and Errol, did you ever take a look, glance up to the bunker and sort of wave to him?
No.
Did you ever have the desire to want to do that? What do you think of me now, Harold?
No, I didn't do that. That's not who I am. But, throughout my career, right, there were times where it was important for me as a captain and a representative of the team to confront Harold with some issues and personal issues on different players that I think I made him probably uncomfortable, but I think it was the right thing to do. We're all entitled, I think, to, when you're being taken advantage of, to stand up for things. And I think Harold respected me for that, for doing that. That's who I am, and I wouldn't change anything if I had to.
So after Red leaves, now Roger Nielsen comes in, and the next season, you have your best season, 77-78 under Roger Nielsen. 117 points, 45 goals, 100 penalty minutes. Of course, Darryl Sittler was never, if the situation called for it, wasn't afraid to drop the mitts if he had to protect himself. I mean, that was part of the game back then, as you mentioned earlier. And that team, again, you got close. You got close, beat the Islanders, right? This is a team that's on the verge of becoming a dynasty. And a lot of people think there was just a little tweaking here or there, and perhaps we got a team that might just get there. But what happened to that team, and what was the problem there?
Well, we were really close. I don't know if there was really a problem. I mean, sometimes it's a fine line. Only one team can win. It's a fine line, who wins the seventh game or whatever it might be. But we did have a good team. Roger Nielsen, to me, was the greatest coach that I ever played for. And the reason I say that, I had so much respect for him. To me, as a coach, your job is to get the most out of the team and the players collectively as you can, and to make each individual feel that their role is as important in the team and the organization as the next guy. And you try to coach so that if you do get to the seventh game, you left no stones unturned. Your conditioning, who you have out there in certain situations. And Roger had all those qualities and did all that. So to me, as a player, I love playing for a guy like that. And he didn't coach through fear. He didn't motivate through fear like some coaches do. He just m motivated you by knowing, hey, he treated you like a man and a person and respected you as a professional player. And the guys put out for him that way. And I think most players who play for him would have those same thoughts. So unfortunately, we didn't win. We were close. And, Roger Nielsen went through his career and never won a cup. But that doesn't mean to me he wasn't a very successful and a good coach. So sometimes you got to be in the right situation with the right circumstances. And it all comes
Right.
together for you. In his case, he was unfortunate and didn't.
Now, things got a little sideways when Punch returned to the Maple Leafs, and you ended up giving up your seat. Tell us about the turmoil at that time and what was going on and why you decided that it was a good idea to take the seat off.
Well, it's a long story, and I'll try to condense it because you only got an hour program here. But
Right.
basically, what happened, I was a vice president of the Players Union, and in the meetings every June, when Punch was the general manager of Buffalo, a lot of our time was spent in those meetings about issues the players were having with Punch Imlach. So I knew when he was fired by Buffalo and hired by Toronto, and he came to Toronto, that there was going to be some confrontation there because I was a vice president and I knew he was going to challenge things. So the first thing he challenged was for Mike Pometier and I to participate in Showdown. It was being taped in September before the season. I had participated in Showdown 2 years previous to that. And the day of Showdown, I got a call into his office, and basically this is how it went. This was in September, the morning of Showdown. He says, "Daryl, sit down." I sit down. He says, "Who do you think you are?" I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "I read in the paper you're going to Showdown." I said, "Yeah, I'm going." He says, "Well, when I'm the general manager, I decide that." He said, "The captain of the team is management, and you do what management says. So if you go to Showdown, you're going to run into some issues." Then he also explained to me that I had no trade contract, and he thought that the no trade contract was invalid. He said to me, Allan Eagleson was my agent. He was also the vice, head of the Players Union, and he and Allan Eagleson didn't see eye to eye. And if I wanted to be the captain of the team and participate, I should consider getting rid of Allan Eagleson. So I went to Showdown. I had to make a choice. And while we were there taking the team picture Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock up at Markham Arena, the trainer came out to center ice. There was a phone call from Allan Eagleson to say that the Leafs had sued Mike Pometier and I, and they were going to go to court at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and would we give Eagleson permission to represent us in court? This is down at Queen's Park. So I said, "Yeah, go ahead." So it goes before the court. The judge throws it out, saying that, "Hey, the Leafs are totally offside. There's a players' agreement between the players and the owners. Blah blah blah. We got into." So that started the whole thing back in September, and as you know, in Toronto, it becomes a major soap opera story, and all of my job, I wanted to play hockey, so to speak. So all those things were happening. Then I was going on Hockey Night in Canada. He banned me from going on between periods. He mentioned that he was going to test my no trade contract in court. He mentioned that to the media guys that I had lost a step. So all these things were happening, right? And the players were getting disgruntled. Floyd Smith was the coach, and at the time, and there wasn't a lot of respect for him because of his things were going on in his own personal life. So what happened was he had Imlach started trading players, right? And that was the team that you were talking about when we beat the Islanders, and we were a pretty close bunch of guys. So come close to Christmas time, Lanny, his wife was 7 or 8 months pregnant. It was Christmas, his family was in, and then he decides to trade him, I think Boxing Day, the day after Christmas. So I remember that morning going home from the rink. We were playing the Canadians, I think, that night. And I said to myself, why am I here? I'm here because I love playing hockey. That's my job to do. I'm just going to take the C off and go do my job and play hockey. Imlach didn't have any respect for me. There wasn't any communication, those sorts of things. So I told my wife, Wendy, what I was going to do. I wrote all the talking points down so that I wouldn't have to talk to the media after the game. So I could hand him a sheet. And I went to the rink that night, nobody knowing other than me. And I came out to warm up, and I asked the trainer, Guy Kinnear, for a thing to take the C off, a little scalpel knife. And I was in the washroom, very emotional. I wasn't a smart ass or anything. And trying to take it off, it was triple stitched, and I didn't want to make a big hole in it and that sort of stuff. So I asked him to do it. And then I went to my teammates and I explained to them what I was doing, and then went to management. It's funny how things can happen. I was trying to time it so that when the buzzer rang, we would go out and start playing, right? The stick boy comes in and he says the Zamboni broke down. The game's going to be delayed. And I'm thinking in my headspace, it's an Imlach tactic, and he's going to come down and tell me to take my equipment off or suspend me or whatever. That never happened. But anyway, that's the reason I took it off. Do I regret it? I just wanted to go out and play. A lot of people don't know this, but the second half of the year, I was second to Gretzky in scoring. And then typical Imlach, he takes the credit for it because he got me motivated, so to speak. But so those are all the things I was dealing with under him, and it wasn't fun. It's not who I am. And one of the things that I felt good about is they asked other players to be the captain after I took it off. And guys like Borey and Tiger said, no, Daryl's our captain, regardless if he has a C on or not. So that to me was very meaningful to me. Not a good time in Leaf history, for sure.
No, those were some pretty brutal times, no doubt about it. You know, right behind you, you got that picture of Terry Fox. And I know Terry meant a lot to you, and you had a chance to meet him. Tell us about that meeting Terry Fox and what that was like for you.
Well, what happened, I was up at my summer home and I picked up a Toronto newspaper and there was an article and there's a picture of Terry Fox on the front page. He just dipped his leg in the Atlantic Ocean and he was going to run across Canada. When I read that article, I thought, gee, here's a guy, he's lost his leg to cancer. He's going to run 26 miles a day, like 26 miles. That's a lot of miles on one leg. So it kind of grabbed me by the heartstrings. And when he went through the Maritime provinces, try to follow me, wasn't getting much exposure or recognition. But when he arrived at the Ontario-Quebec border, the president of the Cancer Society in Ontario met him there and said, listen, when you're coming through Ontario, if there's anything special would you like to do, we'd be happy to do it for you. Terry Fox had two requests. He wanted the opportunity to maybe meet Bobby Orr and to meet Daryl Sutter. I guess we were his favorite players as a kid growing up in Port Coquitlam. So when they phoned me and said, hey, do you want to meet Terry Fox? I said, oh, but I wanted to meet Terry Fox. So they set it up. He was coming through Toronto, July the 11th. And on my way down from my summer home, I said to myself, what could I do that would be special for Terry? So I went home and I grabbed my All-Star jersey, put it in a brown paper bag. And he had no idea it was coming. I go in, he had finished 13 miles. I go into his hotel downtown Yorkville and I open the door. Hey, would you like to go for a run? And I always remember the expression on his face and on my face when we first met, and then we went out, the streets were lying down University Avenue, and I kind of just stayed back and watched him, and people were crying and donating money and cheering him on and all those emotions. We go into Nathan Phillips Square and I don't know how many people were there, 10,000-15,000 people, but it was an unbelievable scene. But I gave him my All-Star jersey from that year, and he put it on. And the picture behind me is Ken Danby was commissioned by Canadian government to depict his run. And Ken Danby didn't know my history or story, but he put that in it. And he gave me a signed a print from him, from Ken Danby. So I have that there because Terry Fox is my hero, even though I was his hero. One of the greatest lessons I learned and one of the best characteristics anybody can have, and Terry had it, is his humility. He was a very humble guy. It wasn't all about him. It was about making a difference and doing it in his own way. And we all know what Terry Fox means to so many of us. There's been over $800 million raised. My grandkids are 5, 6, and 7. Their schools have Terry Fox runs, and I'm still involved with it. So to me, he's, if not the greatest Canadian ever, to do what he did in such a short period of his life. But it took a lot of volunteers, corporate partners, and sponsors, and family members to keep his legacy going on. So that's my Terry Fox story, and I love telling it.
Yeah, you're beautiful. Now, you lost your late wife, Wendy, in October 2001, and that was a year and a half before had your banner raised to the rafters, and you insisted that Wendy was part of that, and she was. And that's an interesting story too. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, yeah, Wendy was a part of my life. I met her in junior hockey. We were married, three kids, and obviously, when you're having a successful career and doing something you love doing, it's important to have that home base and stability. And she was the glue that helped me through a lot of things, and my kids, you know. So when she died of colon cancer, basically before that, Ken Dryden had called me. I always remember the call. We were at our home in East Amherst, New York, and he said, "Daryl, we're going to honor you and Frank Mahovlich on the 75th anniversary, opening night of the Leafs game. We're going to put the 227s up," which was, I remember that call, it was great. And then I said to Ken, you know, Wendy's going through chemo and a tough time. He said, "Well, if it works, works. If it doesn't, I totally understand." So I didn't do it. That was October 3rd when they raised Frank's banner. Wendy died on October the 6th. It was a Thanksgiving weekend. And so what happened was they said to me, just pick a time when you're ready to do it. So I waited, and I wanted to get through kind of the emotional thing of her death and my family and all those sorts of things. And I wanted to do it when the Leafs were playing on a Saturday night against the Montreal Canadiens, because they were my favorite team. John Beliveau was my childhood idol as a kid. So Ken respected that. We picked a date. And then a few weeks before, he called me in his office, and he showed me an artist rendering of what the banner was going to look like. And I just said, "Hey, wouldn't it be nice if I was allowed to put Wendy's name on it because of the circumstances?" And there was some hesitancy on Ken's part, knowing that he'd have to go to the board of directors and concerned about other players might want their things on it. But I insisted that this was something special and meaningful to me. And I respect the wishes they do. So on her banner that night when it was going up, Hockey Night in Canada, my kids were on the ice. They zoomed in on Wendy, and it was her hand signature of her name, just Wendy. There wasn't a dry eye in the place and across Canada. And to me, that was my greatest moment of my hockey career. You can talk about goals and points and all that sort of stuff, but that kind of brought it all together and for all of us. So I really appreciated the Leafs to do that. And when we moved the banners, which we did in the 100th anniversary, those banners came down and they gave us the opportunity. They took them to your hometown. So that banner is in St. Jacob's at the St. Jacob's Market, where I worked as a kid selling bacon and sausages and stuff like that. But the new banner up there, they put Wendy's name on it too. So very meaningful story to me. To me, that's what it's all about. It's not all just about goals and assists and Stanley Cups, although they're meaningful, but the human side of it is just as important and respectful. So.
Yeah, things you know, worked out really well with the Leafs when they, you know, Cliff Fletcher came around and welcomed you back in the organization, welcomed other people back in the organization. And then, as you mentioned, Ken Dryden and then Brendan Shanahan. And, you know, things are so much different now than they were back then. I know that, you know, you talked about the fact that you're involved with the Canadian Cancer Society. And it's one of the many, many, many charities that you're involved with. Ronald McDonald House, which you helped start. Scotiabank Hockey College, Wendy's Bears for colon cancer, help people who want to die, you know, with their families at home, but obviously close to your heart, as well as Ryan and Megan and Ashley, and the Baycrest Pro-Am for Alzheimer's, Diabetes, Special Olympics, Road Hockey to Conquer Cancer. We go on and on and on. And now we're involved with a charity called the recently launched Restaurant and Bar Support Fund. And now to bring in another voice to speak on this, a guy who was born in the Azores, raised in Canada, spent 15 years in the financial sector, former senior executive with the OLG, president, CEO of Gotskill. He brings various entertainment options to establishments, served on the boards for Runnymede Healthcare Center. He was chair, Mad Canada chair, Canadian Soccer League executive. Ladies and gentlemen, Tony Carvalho joins us on the program now. Tony, thanks for joining us, and thanks for being here, and thanks for sitting in with Daryl and I today. And I'm sure you got a lot of, enjoyed this as much as I have.
Yeah, learned a lot of things, and I was thinking, why did we ask Daryl to assist? I'd met Daryl before, and I've worked with Daryl a couple years ago, and. You know, what you heard. He's a great guy. He's a caring guy. I think he's well loved by a lot of people in Canada, and he's very generous. So when I asked him if he would assist us with this, it's a new fund we just started. We're trying our best to raise as much money as we can to help bars and restaurants. He came aboard, and I don't think he mentioned this, but Daryl's mom used to have a restaurant, so he knows what it's like.
Right. So tell us more about the restaurant and bar support fund.
In the States, there's a fund called the Barstool Fund, and we sort of copied their idea. And the idea is to try to raise money and take that money and give it out as grants to bars and restaurants. As we all know, they've taken a huge hit. Many times they've been locked down, the hours are restricted, and some places have been able to do patio service, but bars and restaurants have struggled. Surveys show that probably close to half of them are in trouble. If this thing continues a few more months, I believe over 10,000 bars and restaurants have already closed in Canada. So it's very, very difficult for them. And in many cases, they are a mom-and-pop operation. And we get taken in by statistics and numbers, et cetera, et cetera. But behind each one of those is a story. It's somebody's dream, somebody's livelihood, it's jobs. And so what we thought was, you know, myself, my company, and other individuals and companies in the sector, let's get together, try to raise money, and give grants to bars and restaurants. It's not a loan. It doesn't have to be repaid. And so we set up a GoFundMe page, and that's what we're trying to do. It's the more awareness of the fund, the more people make donations, and that's why I'm here, and that's why Daryl's been kind enough to lend his name to the charity, the not-for-profit.
So tell me, Daryl, what was your motivation to be involved in the charity?
Well, I met Tony before, first of all, so I knew he was a good guy and it was reputable, and again with my mom being in the restaurant business, a tough business to begin with. And obviously with COVID and these shutdowns, it's so, so difficult. So I feel for all those people who lost their jobs. So, you know, some of them are, you know, they got two or three employees, some of them have more than that. So when he asked me to get involved to try to create some awareness, why not? I'm always a believer. You mentioned some of the charities I'm involved in and opportunities come up that, hey, if you sit on the sidelines and do nothing, probably nothing's gonna happen, right? But you get involved, who knows, you might make a difference, and there's a chance you will make a difference. And I look back on my life, the things that I've got involved with, I'm happy about. You talk about Terry Fox or Sick Kids or Ronald McDonald House. Those were all ideas that started up with a charity, but you look at where they've grown today. So that's why I'm involved in this, and we can make a difference. If everybody kicks in $25 that you pay for a meal, think about how many $25 can add up to maybe that $1,000 or $5,000 that somebody get might make a difference for keep their business open or not. So that's why I'm involved.
Well, we need these, you know, we kind of, I think if you, most people just think about this, well, you know, it's a bar, it's a restaurant, it's not that big a deal. But if I just look back at my life and think about the significant relationships that I've developed over the years, and what percent, including my wife, you know, and you know, think about how we've, you know, we've met and developed these relationships in a restaurant, you know, and in a social situation in a bar. I mean, whatever. It's like, you know, it's pretty significant that we've all had some great experiences at our local restaurants and bars. It's a place where people come together and they share things, they share their lives, and you know, I just can't imagine a world where we didn't have that kind of, you know, where these bars started folding left, right, and center because they just can't stay open anymore. So, you know, we really need to step up here. And I think, you know, it's important that we do that. By the way, the website is restaurantandbarsupportfund.ca. And so go to the website, you know, do what you can. If you can, you know, make a donation, great. But another thing I'd like, you know, us all to do is you know, think about where you're going to have dinner tonight, right? I mean, think about how you're going to have dinner tonight. I mean, I understand bars and restaurants are closed, but takeout, right? You know, the bars and restaurants are open for takeout, and, you know, we try to get out and we try to do takeout as much as possible. You know, it's a way for us to help any way we can. Any other suggestions, Tony?
No, I think, as you said, think of all the things that, you know, you celebrate birthdays, anniversaries, promotions, graduations, you do them at these places. And we want to make sure that when we come out of this, these places are around so we can continue to have those types of celebrations and get together with our friends. And so we're asking people to make the donation of the equivalent of a typical meal, $25, as Daryl said. We also have a shorter URL, which is rabsfund.ca. And we would ask everybody to make a donation, help these places so that they're there when we come out of this pandemic.
Before I let you guys go, I want to touch on this year's edition of the Maple Leafs, because we didn't talk about that earlier, Daryl. What are your thoughts on this Leafs team? Is this maybe the best Leafs team you've seen, or are we close to that?
Well, we do have a good team, and I think what was nice, management recognized some of our shortcomings over the summer. I mean, we haven't won a playoff round, obviously, and we've been knocking at the door, so they went out and got a little bit more experience, a little bit more depth, and some grit. And obviously, goaltending is as important as anything, and you know, that's a key to getting us there. So guys like Austin Matthews and Mitch Marner, they're a little bit more mature, Morgan Rielly, and they're coming to play every night. And I think the management has really instilled in the players right from the get-go, from training camp, that it's how you practice day in and day out, and you play each game like it's a playoff game, so that when you get to the playoffs, it's the normal thing to do. And I've seen more of that this year than any other year, and I'm excited about it. It's going to be challenging. It's tough. As you know, we're in a, you know, division with the Connor McDavids of the world. It won't be easy, but we're off to a good start, and I like what I see.
Tony, any thoughts on their Maple Leafs?
I started watching hockey in 1968, so hopefully I get to see a Stanley Cup.
Me too. Well, I think that, yeah, what some of the thoughts that I have watching this year's team, and I really think that you know, Kyle Dubas did a great job in the offseason of addressing the problems that they had. They added the sandpaper and experience with Thornton and Simmons. TJ Brody has really solidified the back end. He's rock solid out there. Jack Campbell has been amazing. I mean, 10-0. And I've got I'm assuming that at some point Freddie Anderson is going to be, you know, back and healthy again. And when you talk about a 1-2 goaltending punch of Jack Campbell and Freddie Anderson, you're looking at something pretty awesome back there. So, Daryl, your thoughts?
I agree. No, and you got to have the goaltending.
Yeah. Right. That always makes a difference, doesn't it? Well, guys, I want to thank you for being on the show. Once again, the book is called Captain, My Life and Career with Daryl Sittler and Mike Leonetti. If you get a chance to get it, you can pick it up on a Kindle or a Kobe or whatever, and or just buy a copy. And, you know, I just want to say, Daryl, just, you know, always been one of my favorite players, and it's been an honor having you on the show here today. Of course, as a guest on Joe Tilley Sports, we got a foursome for you from ClubLink. We're all in it together. When we come back, we've got some basketball and Leafs news and more. See you then. Thank you, guys.
Okay, thank you.
Promotional consideration provided by ClubLink. ClubLink. One membership, more golf.
Excuse me. Yeah, let me introduce you to Steve. Having the round of his life, finally gonna pick up some skins, then he gets here, and now this. Try entering and exiting the bunker on the same low side, and then just a couple of swipes with this to clean things up, and everything will be hunky-dory.
Addiction Rehab Toronto, Toronto's number one alcohol and drug treatment center, saving lives, reuniting families. The only treatment center in the province to offer medical detox, treatment, sober living, and lifetime aftercare all in one place. Our unique and specialized programs are designed to equip our clients with the tools to successfully lead a life of dignity, respect, and purpose. Let us help save your life or your loved one's life. Call today for more information or to facilitate an intervention. 1-855-787-2424 or visit addictionrehabtoronto.ca. Joe Tilly Sports is brought to you by COSA, Central Ontario Standardbred Association, providing a united voice for harness horse people racing at Ontario tracks. Check out your benefits today at COSAonline.com and check out COSA TV on Facebook and YouTube for all the latest harness news and live action updates. Live racing year-round. Go to HPIBet.com for all your wagering options. Become a member today and your first bet is free. That's HPIBet.com. Time now for our weekly sports analytics segment. Here's Kwame Bryan.
Hi, my name is Kwame. I'm a developer ambassador at Algorand, and it's a great honor to bring the stats for today's show. Darryl Sittler, great leaf, Hall of Famer, John Tavares, I think he's going to be a future Hall of Famer. And you can see from their London Knights career that they both had very similar stats. And I can see that they're going to have very similar careers. That's it for me. See you in the next show.
All right. Thanks, Kwame. Now it's time for my Swiss pick of the week. And I wasn't able to get back into the winner's circle last week. I took the number one horse, Dr. Joe, in last Thursday night's ninth race in Mohawk. Dr. Joe looked like he was ready to make a move when he broke stride heading into the final turn. Whoops. Thinking of Slim with Louis-Philippe Roy in the buggy. Finished huge at 24-1, slipping past Northern Baccarat at the wire. The 3-5 exactor paid $256.30 on a $2 ticket. My record on the year, by the way, is 4 wins, 2 seconds, a third, a fourth, an eighth, and now a tenth. Horse racing has been suspended in Ontario due to the latest lockdown, even though they had zero cases, and they really should fall into that pro sports category where they exempt from the lockdown, but that's the way it is. For all racing updates, visit COSA TV on Facebook. And go to HPIBet.com for all your wagering options. There are tracks racing in various parts of North America that you can wager on. Well, Austin Matthews has made this a one-horse race for the Rocket Richard Trophy. Imagine how many goals this guy would have had if he played an 82-game schedule. He's got 28 goals. And what a start to his career for Jack Campbell as Maple Leaf. 10-0, staying perfect. Phenomenal Freddie, phenomenal record. Freddie, you know, take all the time you need to get back, but no hurry to get back from his latest injury. When he does return, as I mentioned earlier, talking to Darryl, I think this is going to be the best 1-2 goaltending punch around. Well, the Rat Pack, we're happy to see March in the rearview mirror. They've already won more games in April than they did in the entire month of March. How about Gary Trent Jr. with the buzzer beater over Washington as the Raps rally from 19 points down? They might just squeak into the playoffs. After all, they're certainly in the hunt. Meanwhile, there's another young Canuck making a name for himself on the big stage in the NBA. Here's Keegan Levine with this week's edition of the Canadian Hoop and Scoop.
Thanks, Joe. Keegan Levine here with yet another episode of Canadian Hoop and Scoop, talking all things Canadian basketball. And as I mentioned last week, we will be discussing Montreal native and Oklahoma City Thunder guard Lugans Dort, who really put himself on the map with his performance in that first round series against the Thunder in the 2020 NBA playoffs in the bubble. His ability to lock up James Harden on the defensive end was something to take note of and something that his coach at the time, Billy Donovan, raved about. And let's not forget about his 30-point performance in Game 7. Though it ended in a loss for the Thunder, it was definitely something for Lou to build off, and he has. This season, he's nearly doubled his scoring average, and plus he's shooting over 30% from the three-point line, which is a solid number for him. And joining me now is Brandon Ennis, a former assistant coach at Orangeville Prep Academy, where Lugans Dort played his senior high school basketball season. What's going on, man?
Nothing much, Keegan. How you been?
Not too bad. It's good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Lugans, you know, spent his senior high school season with you at Orangeville Prep. And again, I want to ask you about his bit about his development and how you saw it since you worked directly with him.
Yeah. Yeah, but first thing, and it's one thing I always tell people whenever we talk about Lou, very first thing was when I went to go pick him up at the bus station, I asked him, I was like, hey, so like, what are some stuff that, you know, you want to improve on and, you know, kind of like take your game to the next level? And two things were his shooting and being more of a point guard, because he felt that being 6'3", he has to be more of a one. And it's funny, like the way the game is changing, like it's become so positionless. But yeah, so a lot of times working in the gym on a daily, no exaggeration, you know, we worked on a lot of his skill sets, worked on a lot of his weaknesses, turned them into strengths, and then a lot of his strengths just to keep them consistent. And with his work ethic, it was literally second to none. Like there were days, you know, I would kind of test him because we would wake up 5 a.m. We would lift first and then do on court. So I remember one day I was like, are we working out tomorrow? He said, no, I'm a little tired. And then I said, as a joke, I was like, okay, I thought you wanted to get to the NBA. My mistake. And then he's like, I'll see you in the morning.
You know, he's turned himself into quite the two-way machine. And you mentioned his work ethic, and a lot of that is seen on defense. So talk to me about his, you know, what you saw when he was at Orangeville Prep, and now what you've seen defensively in the NBA, and what overall has impressed you the most.
I think it's the fact that the biggest thing that stands out to me is he always has a tough assignment, and it's been recorded that he has the highest difficulty rating of like guarding per player per game, and that's something amazing to see, because that's basically what I see is the coaches trusting Lou in his second year to guard the best player on the team every single night. But yeah, it's just amazing to see, like, man, like he's guarding LeBron, he's guarding Westbrook, he's guarding James Harden, he's like some of the best scorers in the league, and he's doing a phenomenal job.
I know you mentioned working on his jump shot a lot, and you it's been seen, right, how well he can shoot the ball now. And just tell me like a little bit about what you've seen from when he was shooting with you at Orangeville Prep to now, and where you've seen the improvements. And I know it's obvious he's definitely more confident, so just tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, like you said, Keegan, it's the biggest thing is his confidence and just trusting in, you know, what we worked on back home in Canada, and just listening to his coaching staff now.
And again, I want to talk about another thing that he did recently is that game-winning shot against the Spurs.
Oh,
and
yeah,
that was incredible. And then I was like, I knew that his first career buzzer beater, and I knew that eventually this would happen with him. And just tell me about your reactions and your feelings about that.
One of the first headlines I saw was like Lugans Dort hits game-winning shot. I'm like, wait, what? So then I click on the link and it shows like the last seconds of it. Spot up in the corner, hit Al Horford. He drives, kicks it out to Lou in the corner, and it goes up. I'm like, no way. And I mean, like, just like we were talking about before, like that confidence, like he's not afraid to take the big shot.
All right, Brandon. Well, I appreciate you coming on the show and give me your insight. It's always a pleasure to talk to you and gain your knowledge. Thank you very much.
No problem, Keegan. Thanks for having me, man.
That was former Orangeville Prep assistant coach Brandon Ennis. It was a pleasure having him on. And tune in next week as I take a look at SGA, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, a teammate of Lugans Dort on the Oklahoma City Thunder, and how his season has been going. For Canadian Hoop and Scoop, I'm Keegan Levine.
Thank you, Keegan. Some positive signs for the Blue Jays early in the season. They took 2 out of 3 from the Yankees in the Bronx, losing a series in Texas. Well, that kind of sucks a little bit. Steven Matz had an impressive debut. Tanner Roark did not. The pitching has been mostly okay. Offensively, they seem to be getting the job done. And remember, George Springer hasn't even played yet. All in all, you have to be okay with the Dunedin Blue Jays. By the way, the Jays gave GM Ross Atkins a 5-year contract extension. Atkins was hired by the Birds in 2015 season. Cleveland's front office. Toronto Atkins has guided the club to a couple of postseason appearances in 5 years. They've got a good shot this year if they stay healthy. Our weekly Joe Tilley Sports Contest heating up. We're giving away some awesome Mitch Marner t-shirts, 3 collector sports prints from the talented artist Rob McDougall. You can enjoy all Rob's work at robmcdougall.com. To enter, just subscribe to Joe Tilley on YouTube. It's easy. It's free. Just do it. 1 t-shirt or print will be handed out this week. We'll notify the winners on the program. And today's winner is Howard Payne. Congratulations, Howard. Give us a buzz. Before we go, we lost a good friend this week, a Canadian broadcasting legend. Tom Gibney passed away. Now, Tom was a rock on the anchor desk at CFTO and CTV for well over 30 years. He was a great guy, respectful to everyone, and what an awesome voice he had. You know, whenever I worked with Tom, he always greeted me with, "And how's Mrs. Tilley's boy doing today?" Great guy, Tom. He was just an awesome guy. His laugh was contagious. He was just a great guy to have her on, and we miss it, Tom. Our condolences go out to his wife, Dawn, and family. Tom Gibney was 84. And we close today with a look at the folks who make their show possible. These are friends, trusted business associates, and all-around great folks. I highly recommend them all. A reminder that the show is also available on the Spanglish Network, Zingo TV, and the Fired Up Network. Once again, thanks to Daryl Sittler and Tony Carvalho and Brandon Ennis. And thank you for watching. We'll see you next week when Canadian judo star Jessica Klimkate and judo/WWE star Anthony Corelli drop by. We'll see you then.
Get Aldo at RE/MAX Crossroads. Do you want to buy or sell a home? Could 31 years of real estate experience help you? Why not speak to an amazing team that loves to overpromise and overdeliver? Call 416-GET-ALDO or visit www.getaldo.com to find out what next level real estate looks like. RS Demolition and Excavation has extensive experience with complete teardowns and interior stripouts. Looking to build a custom home? RS Excavating Services has the experience you need to build in established neighborhoods. For the highest level of quality and cost-efficient results, we provide innovative demolition solutions completed on time and on budget while ensuring our number one priority, safety. Call 647-852-3006 for an estimate or visit rsdemolition.ca. Brian Gribben Insurance Planning, helping you solidify your financial future.
At BGIP, what we do that's unique in the marketplace is we show people how to spend and enjoy their money in their early years of retirement without the fear of running out. Also, we're able to do this without you having to change financial advisors. Please look us up at bgip.ca today. Let's book a 30-minute phone call to see how we can bring value to you and your family in your planning.
Call Brian today for all your retirement needs. We did. 905-686-5678. Gold Line Resources, discovering high-grade gold in Sweden. Gold Line Resources owns a prospective portfolio of 4 high-grade gold exploration projects located on the Gold Line mineral belt of north-central Sweden and 1 gold exploration project in the Skellefteå belt of north-central Sweden. For more information on how you can invest in this new initiative, go to goldlineresources.com or call 1-800-858-9710. Gold Line Resources can also be found on the TSX Ventures Exchange as GLDL. Looking for an advantage in choosing your investment options? Belmont Venture Capital will provide you with the best up-to-date opportunities in the mid-cap and junior sector. The company was formed 12 and a half years ago and is spearheaded by 2 seasoned veterans of the financial markets with over 80 years combined experience. Go to BelmontVentureCapital.com today for the latest hot picks on the market. And don't forget to sign up for the newsletter. BelmontVentureCapital.com.